Good morning, everyone who is listening into this session. And thank you for joining us on this journey today virtually. And before we move further, we would like to talk something about us, a little bit about us. So as you can see, my name is Ashish Gupta, and I'm tech lead on API Gateway and tokenization platform at Capital One. And I've been with this company for about 3 years now. And I have with me Vinayak Holawale, who is been a lead engineer on lots of platforms that we have built over the period of several years, including API Gateway. And he has been with Capital One for about 7 years. I hope we had a great session today, and continuing on the journey, we would like to talk about how we leveraged or embraced open source at Capital One to build highly resilient, performant, and scalable platform that powers about 12 billion transactions a day and going strong. At Capital One, we started our journey into the cloud about 6 years ago. And like every other organization, we had our own set of challenges. We had multiple different platforms, mostly, you know, cards from the different vendors, which were monolith, very hard to scale, very difficult to maintain, and they were, very difficult to maintain and developed in silos. These platforms were very tightly coupled, and they're very, very tightly coupled. We clearly knew that these platforms were not designed for our journey into the cloud. Many of these platforms that we had built or had were highly redundant, evolving in their own direction with lack of governance and no clear roadmap. And most importantly, they were lagging or tailing on the industry standards. While we aspired to move our journey into the cloud, we wanted to be very cautious of not carrying this baggage into the cloud as it is. And we wanted to build a platform that was highly robust, scalable, and resilient, and most important, it was current with the technology and the industry standards. So in order to build this platform, we had a very short span of time, and we had to do a lot. We thought, why not start this journey with the strong community of the open source and leverage the work that delivered by thousands of engineers on a daily basis. So in a very short span of time, we built three highly resilient and scalable platforms at Capital One. API Gateway. API Gateway is the hub of all the API experiences that we build today and provides industry standard API lifecycle management, resilient routing, standards with authentication and authorization, routing, third-party integrations, and much more. It abstracts all the cross-cutting concerns for the developers at Capital One and allows them to focus on building really experiences that truly matter for our customers. The API Gateway platform that we have today serves about 4 billion transactions a day with a peak of 150,000 requests a second, with a mere average latency of less than a millisecond, which is really fascinating for us for what we have built using the open source technology. While journey into the cloud was not only about moving the applications into the cloud, we had to also migrate or take care of our data. In our ecosystem, the NPI, PCI, and the PII data that we hold has non-compromisable security concerns. We cannot afford to have data lying around in different systems being accessed in a multiple different ways with having different access controls. So we revised our data protection strategy in a way to change how the different systems stored their data, consumed the data, and most importantly, how they moved the data between their systems. We built a very innovative tokenization platform to revise our entire strategy to centralize how the data was protected in the system, and more importantly, how they were being used and distributed across the systems within the Capital One. And this platform today powers about 12 billion tokenizations per day with a peak of 3.5 million transactions per second. That's a lot, with a mere average latency of about 40 milliseconds. We didn't even stop there. We went to build another platform called virtual payment cards, which basically changes how the Capital One customers use their plastic cards while shopping with merchants online or the POCs or point of sales. And this particular platform today handles 200,000 operations per day. With this, I would like to transfer it to Vinayak, turn it over to Vinayak.
Thanks, Ashish. So we'll see why we selected OSS for the solution, right? So let me start from the beginning. Back in the day, around like before 2012, Capital One used to describe itself as a marketing company that does a business as a bank. But around 2013, 2014 timeframe, Capital One realized the criticality of software development and engineering for financial services company. Literally everything that we produce is powered by software. And because of that, we started to pivot towards becoming whatever CEO Richware Bank likes to call a technology company that does business as a bank. And first thing in that journey was to treat our customers before our real customers as a first-class citizens in our ecosystem. And those customers are our developing and engineering community. There was a conscious effort from our leadership to empower this community. We were encouraged to look beyond off-the-shelf commercial product to modernize our internal applications. So we had, in this journey, the first step was to get rid of our monolithic services and transition to microservices. We had various legacy SOAP services that were deployed on a popular enterprise service bus product at that time. And we started our journey to migrate that to REST and make sure those REST services can embrace change as a continuous process. So we break down those SOAP services into small microservices. Our focus was on highly resilient and highly available services. And more importantly, developing a platform, a high performing platform that these services could leverage and make use of. And at the time, it was very clear that existing off-the-shelf solutions will be very difficult to scale. Also, it would be a time-consuming process to add any customization, add any new features to those. So open source was really the choice that could win us in this game. So we started looking around a various solution. Our first or down the years, we had various gateways in our company. One of the project that was as part of this was to consolidate all these products into one. Those three gateways were like legacy service bus that I talked about. There were some SOAP and XML gateways. We also had a REST-based vendor API gateway. And we were exploring various options. And during that process, one of our team member pitched a solution based on Nginx and Lua. We know Nginx, right? Nginx is well known for its reverse proxy capabilities. It was famously created for solving C10K problem. It has large user base, event-driven architecture, and very low memory footprint. And one of the advantage is like it can support zero downtime upgrade. And the user community for Nginx is large. But Lua was new for us. At the time, we knew that it was used for developing high performance gaming applications, but that's about it. There is an interesting story about a prototype that we developed for this, right? Earlier, like when this solution was pitched, there was not many takers inside our company to go on this stack. The team member that pitched this solution was very confident about this stack. He took it upon himself to build a prototype. He built it in the span of a month. And he did it as a part of his side of desk. And after a month, the prototype was ready and it was running on a USB powered BeagleBone with ARM processor. And that setup was actually capable of running our 70 to 75% production SOAP traffic on that BeagleBone itself. Remember, our production systems were 32 core 120 gig RAM and deployed in state of the art data center. So needless to say, this prototype got a good amount of press and it was evaluated properly. We did more evaluation for this tech stack and then we decided to go with this. Now, why this stack was so performant, right? Why Nginx? Why Lua? So let's talk about more about Nginx, right? As you might be aware, Nginx has multiple worker processes and master processes. It also has cache loader and cache manager processes, which manages the cache, which is actually used for optimizing serving static content from memory. The job of the master process is to load the configuration, manage the worker processes, and in the process, if any worker processes goes down, it will restart it. This is a very good feature to have, right? Like if you have a single process and if it goes down, you need another external process to manage that. But with Nginx, you get this out of the box. Your master process will take care of any process that goes down and bring it up. Another advantage of worker process, right? Though these are all single threaded processes. So while coding, when you're writing a code for Nginx, you don't need to worry about thread safety, logs, synchronization, etc. Nginx takes care of all these things using its event loop. I would like to caution one thing here though. You should not writing any blocking code when you're writing for, when you're targeting for worker process, because any blocking IO code will actually block that worker, and then it will impact your performance as well. So that care should be taken when you're writing any code targeted towards Nginx. Now, in earlier slides, we talked about Nginx can serve thousands of active connections per node, right? How does Nginx do that? The secret is this event-driven architecture. Nginx has listen sockets and multiple connection sockets. So whenever you get a request on a listening port, Nginx creates a new connection socket and add it to the its event queue. And whenever there is an event like read or write, that event is processed by worker. And whenever there is that socket is waiting for an event, that gets put in the queue and worker continues processing other events from that queue. This enables one worker to simultaneously serve thousands of connections. And in effect, it allows, since we have multi-worker process, it allows Nginx to serve hundreds of thousands of active connections at the same time. The other feature that I like about Nginx is its zero downtime grid. So typically, if you change something in your application, you will stop the application, then start the application, right? So with that, there is a possibility of downtime. You may do blue-green to avoid that, but you have a downtime there. With Nginx, Nginx has a capability of reload that works in a way such that if you change any configuration and if you send a reload signal to master process will spawn new processes which inherits the new config. So now you have old processes which are actively serving the active traffic, and these are the new worker processes that are coming up which are based on the new config. And whenever these new workers are ready, they'll start serving the new request. And the existing worker will still continue to serve old traffic which they were processing. And once old processes have served or fulfilled all their requests and they become idle, master process will shut it down. And now you have new worker processes with new config and without a downtime, without losing a single request. So this is a very neat feature of Nginx that I particularly like about it. Now let's talk about Nginx performance, right? So we talked about memory usage and the amount of traffic that Nginx can serve. This is the comparison that we have with various competitor of Nginx. This is a little bit older slide, but still you can see as number of active connection are increasing, Nginx memory footprint stays the same. And the request per second, it decreases a little bit, but not by much against if you compare against its competitor. So this was, Nginx was the apt choice for our platform where we needed high performance and low memory footprint. Next, as Lua language, right? So Nginx is a proven product, but Lua was new for us. So like what we knew about Lua, Lua is primarily a scripting language, which is used by gaming application to extend its capabilities. It is also used in embedded software. It also used by various applications that want to extend C code. It's very lightweight. If you look at the footprint, it's downloadable in KBs. Plus, it was developed in a university in Brazil. The word Lua means moon in Portuguese. So that's why you will see when you go to Lua site, you will always see references to moon everywhere. Lua works in all the platform that has a standard C compiler. Let's look at the next slide where you can see that the Lua has support for various platform, almost all the platform. Windows, Linux, BSD, Mac, you can run Lua on all these platforms. Plus, we use a jitted version of Lua called LuaJIT, which makes Lua perform at par with statically compiled C code. If you take the example of zeroMQ binding, if you see on the slide, we have a comparison between a C++ native code and the LuaJIT or jitted Lua code. And if you see, there is a very small overhead if you see the throughput between these two. And writing Lua code is very simple. If you write a Lua code, you just have to worry about a couple of data structures, few routines. It's very easy to master Lua. It's very easy to, you can also mimic OOP functional programming with Lua. I can guarantee that in a couple of days, you would be able to learn Lua and write Lua language efficiently. Next, let's talk about a little bit about LuaJIT. So this slide shows how LuaJIT amplifies Lua's performance. These benchmarks are directly taken from LuaJIT site. As you can see, with LuaJIT, some of these benchmarks performs 8x, 16x, 32x more than Lua. And this is what we used along with Nginx to develop our application. We used a open source package called OpenRST, which already binds them together and makes it available to develop application on top of it. Now, let's talk about who are the leading Lua users. As we already talked about, Lua is popular among gaming developers, but it is also used by Adobe. Alibaba is using for its commercial portal, even Cloudflare, the largest CDN network. The Edge web servers are powered by Nginx Lua stock of Cloudflare. So you can imagine the performance requirement for those Edge servers, and Nginx Lua stack is actually delivering that capability. It is also used in NASA. Incidentally, that was the point was made during when this solution was pitched. Like, it is also used in NASA, so it is safe to use in Capital One. That was one of the points that we pitched when we did this. It is used to extend Barracuda's capability. It is used to extend Wireshark. There are various performance measuring tools that can be extended using Lua, like WRK, WRK2. Redis is extensible by Lua. You can write Lua scripts to do in-server or local comparison, which is faster. RocksDB, which is from the Facebook, uses Lua internally. Torrent tool can also be extended by Lua. And now Capital One is also using Lua for its critical applications like gateway, tokenization, and more. So this is what we did, right? we were doing when we built our API gateway, we've leveraged these platforms and built more platforms as well. Like Ashish told you, we had tokenization, virtual payment cards, and this is what we did. We extracted our high speed core. We extracted, we focused on the high performing our code, and then all other services were developed in Java and other, but the core system which needed to be performant was developed in Nginx Lua. Ashish will talk about more about these now.
As we heard from Vinayak that we already made an unorthodox choice of selecting the framework or the stack or the open source system for building our how performant platform. But then while we adopted this technology stack, we were always mindful and invested a lot on making the architectural decisions so that we could keep this particular core as lean and as performant as possible. We did not want to go back into the same stone age where we started from by building tight coupling with different systems. We ensured that the high speed core was gonna be very, very lean and only gonna focus on managing the connections on the client side or the upstream connections, providing authentication, authorizations, protecting the backends from the surge in the traffic through throttling, rate limiting. But it was all gonna be about it. But anything that was specific to the client or the streams that were going to consume the services, we ensured that those were gonna be singled out as a separate entities, and any specific behavior were only implemented on those systems, so that we do not couple the systems tightly, and that would allow us to scale seamlessly and flexibly in the future. Anything that involved user interactions or very, very specific behavior that was related to the features, we single them out into a microservices and either develop them as a plugin or as a microservice which could be used in a plug and play model so that it does not interfere with the core processing logic all the time, and we could deliver a high performance. Now the backend APIs that were sitting behind this high speed code, we defined standardized interfaces so that these particular backend APIs can be built flexibly by the backend owners. They could scale independently, and they got all the information that they needed from the user or the request context to build the core business logic. So in a way we attempted, we put all the optimizations in place, and even today we continue to optimize this framework and architecture in a way that we make sure there is less and less amount of coupling between the system, so each one of them can scale independently to deliver the high performance and the throughput that is required by our users, clients within Capital One. Moving on to the next slide. So while we were doing all these things, we went very strong on certain guiding principles so that we could meet our non-functional requirements even under the peak load. No matter what kind of transactions were being carried out on the platform, we wanted to stay, you know, par and upfront on that. We went very light on the AC transactions, and wherever it was possible, we only resorted to those kind of AC transactions when we were very sure that the data being used cannot be computationally generated even with the sufficient compute capacity we had without compromising the performance. We made sure the systems were very, very stateless, and we leveraged, you know, as much of immutable data as we could so that we could cache them indefinitely. And this allowed us to weather certain very, very disastrous situations like failing of a node, a particular region or a particular zone. We could seamlessly serve the traffic from anywhere without impacting the customer experience, and still, you know, true to our promised SLA for the non-functional requirements. Even if we resorted to the, you know, the AC transactions and adopted persistent stores, we were very mindful in separating our reads from the writes. We just wanted to make sure that our SLAs for the reads and the writes were honored even under the peak loads. We also analyzed the kind of data that were flowing through our systems or being used by the customers, how frequently they were accessing, what were their different access patterns. And we used all that particular analysis into partitioning our data in a way so that whenever we could have to serve the data, we could parallelize the request, we could batch the request, so that we could meet the SLAs. We went heavy on the micro batch processing. So generally we had certain APIs within Capital One which would have multiple elements within the payload. And if you go with the rudimentary or the traditional approach of processing each element in the payload and where you have involvement to talk to multiple processing systems. So back and forth within the network itself, you know, think about other systems sitting across the geography would lost you or would lose you a couple of milliseconds. And doing it over for a multiple element is gonna be disastrous. So how we designed was we started batching the request, and any system that we're talking to, we equally made sure that supported batching. That allowed us to use the network bandwidth between the two interacting components very, very effectively and improve our throughput. Delivering an experience sometimes can involve more than a dozen APIs or interactions. And it only becomes harder if you have to do all these things only with a slice of time, because you have your client, you have your network in between, and then you have backend, which have to do further complex processing, you know, to deliver the customer experience. Coupled to that, if you have all these transactions falling onto the particular database, it's gonna cost further. And if we are very much worried about the durability of the data, you will see that many of the times the transactional systems, they fall onto the database. And if we have to worry about the availability of the database and the durability of the data, we often resort to distributed systems. And getting an ACID compliance on the distributed system is really hard, because you have nodes which could be sitting right next to you across the geography. And how much time does it take for the nodes to get synchronized with the particular data? In case the node goes down, how they identify who the leader is, who is going to serve that particular data? And it also depends that what is the consistency level of data that you want to use for serving a request. Higher the consistency that you expect from the particular system, the more the response time is gonna take. So we were very, very cautious about choosing that when we wanted to have a dependency on the persistence system for processing our request. We did choose to have the persistent storage for some of the systems, like for example, issuing the virtual credit card numbers. We knew that this particular data we could not generate. It becomes an identity of the particular user. If somebody was tokenizing an NPI or PCI data, we knew that a unique data is bound to a unique token, and we could not generate the same value every time. So once we issued the value, we had to go and persist that particular value. But we made certain trade-offs there as well, which we'll talk about in the next slide. But then some of the other operations, like, you know, logging or reading of the immutable data, we kept it, you know, outside of the ACID transactions. Now, I mean, looking at that, I mean, we tried to make our systems as stateless as possible with the immutable data. Whenever we thought that this data we can generate computationally, having enough capacity, we went ahead with that, because it allowed our systems to scale both horizontally and vertically. We could weather any kind of failures. If you look at today, you know, many API gateway systems, you know, they store access tokens in the database. Anybody who has a prior experience of building applications using APIs behind the API gateway would know that the very first step to consuming the API would be trading your credentials to get a Starfleet token and using that tokens to make the subsequent API calls. Imagine the case of the platform that we're talking about, which handles about 150 to 200 requests per second. At this particular rate, if we have to go to the database for generating every token, validating every token, we are gonna throw our entire performance away. So what we did at Capital One, we split this entire token lifecycle into two pieces. We went into, you know, staying true to our immutable journey, we generated a stateless JWE tokens, which we could cryptographically validate and authorize and issue. Now, if the tokens were to be compromised or the tokens were to be expired, and if we went through the traditional approach of, you know, having all those data persisted into the database and updates at that particular speed, no matter, you know, how you scale your database, at some point of time, you would run out of your capacity and resources. You start building up the latency. Here, we could revoke the tokens easily because we were doing a lot of things within the memory. For tokenization use cases, like for example, when we were dealing with the NPI or PCI data, we knew that, you know, if somebody tokenizes a social, and next time we issue a token, and every time they come next time, the tokens is gonna be saved. The tokens were immutable. It allowed us to, you know, keep those tokens there in memory. Now, we understood, you know, we had certain platforms which has like a couple of 10 terabytes of data that they had to handle, and majority of this particular data was used in the real-time system. Say, for example, somebody was into the Capital One, logging to the Capital One website looking for their account, or they were going for a, you know, credit card application. All these particular socials and the PCI data had to be processed, or the tokens had to be generated within milliseconds of latency. And since the data was going to be persisted, we decided consciously to separate our read and write workloads. So that allowed us to guarantee the SLAs for all the read and write operations that are serving out of our system. And not only that, we even took our read replicas, you know, the read copies, made them regional so that the users coming for a particular region did not experience latency even though they were following onto the read replicas. So we were able to cache lot of this particular data, and over the repeated transactions and requests that were coming to our systems, we could quickly respond back. So just like I spoke, we had systems that were handling about 10 or 12 terabytes of data. Now, if we had to serve this data to all our customers, some of them were real time, some of them were batch, some of the data that was being used very frequently and some of them were used less frequently, we had to understand the pattern. We started dividing the data into multiple shards, the shards which were having, the data that was being used more frequently, accessed more frequently, and that had SLAs attached to those data. We started moving them into their dedicated clusters. So that allowed us to expand those clusters independently without impacting the compute capacity or the storage capacity that we had for the other data that was least frequently used. We already spoke about partitioning the data. We not only partitioned the data in the persistent storage, we in fact started partitioning even in the server memory cache or even in the different layers of caching, like elastic cache we adopted for a higher throughput. So everywhere we started partitioning the data depending on how they were used, why they were used, and how oftenly they were used. We spoke about the micro batching. All the systems that we had, since the APIs were involving many, many elements in the request, we started splitting those elements. And even though the systems were distributed, we could send that particular chunk of data at one shot to the target system. That allowed us to parallelize all our requests and in fact improve the number of connections that we required for each and every transaction, both at our side and at the target end side. That allowed us to improve the throughput of the entire ecosystem of components as a whole. So in particularly in case of tokenization, we identify, at Capital One, we have our own field level data protection standards. We identify like tons of fields which are supposed to be, protected. And depending on the use case of each field and how they were used, we sharded all our data to secure them safely and make them faster to access. Over to you, Vinayak.
Okay, thanks, Ashish. So as Ashish explained the architecture principle and the tech stack that we discussed earlier, using those principles and that tech stack, we were able to deliver the API Gateway product to our stakeholders. And these are the functionality that were built in that product. We had all the OAuth 2 specification built in. We were authenticating using OAuth 2 MTLS. Routing capabilities was implemented, load balancing, request response transformation, token revocation, all this functionality along with cloud deployment scripts were delivered on time. And you can see the platform numbers that we saw earlier. So this was a resounding success for our team as well as company. We were able to meet our performance need for that time as well as now. And we are very confident to meet our performance need in near future as well. And so this is what we call it as a success using open source, because it allowed us to innovate faster, bring change faster, adapt to changing requirements. And based on this success of this stack, right, as we talked about different applications, we used it for our tokenization, our virtual payment cards. How we did this? What we did, we extracted the core features in a platform, and then we built reusable modules around it. We'll talk about that next slide. So this slide tries to depict our platform in a whole. We have our base as Nginx. OpenSSD provides the Lua binding capability, we have some of our own patches that are that goes into this platform, and that forms the core of our platform. And then these are various modules that we developed for this platform. Some of these are open source modules, which we enhanced internally, like MySQL, Redis Connector, Datadog. All these are, some of these modules are available as open source modules. The enhancements that we did, we are trying to open source that, but being a bank, we need to follow a little bit of more processes. So you will soon see some of these modules on Capital One's GitHub.org for all other OpenRESTy or Lua community to leverage. As part of this, we also contributed vastly to open source as well. There were multiple contribution. The notable contribution I have listed on this slide. The first is actual MTLS, mutual TLS support between Nginx and the backend, or as we like to call it, upstream. When we started, Nginx didn't have that capability. And since our traffic inside Capital One is encrypted end to end, it was a must have for us. So we patched the Nginx and also submitted that patch back to Nginx public repo as well. As we talked about, we use our OAuth token as JWE tokens. The existing open source library did not have the support for encryption. We implemented JWE support and contributed back. We also added asymmetric, that is RS encryption support to that. Redis library, the open source library didn't have the SSL capabilities, and it was required for us internally. So SSL support was implemented internally, and it got contributed back to the open source as well. Apart from that, we also contributed to MySQL library. We also used Redis cluster internally. So we made some of the improvements made into the open source. Some are in the process. We also contributed to the OpenSSL module to enable the certificate issuing capability for that particular module, which we use internally. There are other projects in pipeline, as I told before, and you should see them soon. Now next, how did we build a community, right? So when we started, Lua was new to us. Lua is not the most popular language. When we started, we didn't have any Lua developer from one guy. Some of us has C background. I'm from Java background. But during this development of this platform and during this journey, we developed the community around the Lua language. Now we have 30 plus developers contributing Lua code, out of which 16 developers are from the core team, and others are from different teams which contributes to this platform. This platform internally used by 70 plus developers. We use our private Lua Rocks repository, which is on par with public luarocks.org, where they host public modules. Internally, we host our own modules. And that publishing those modules is also automated just to reduce the overhead. We also produce binary as well as Docker images for multiple architecture platforms like Ubuntu, Amazon, Red Hat, CentOS, as well as Alpine. And again, all these images, binaries are pushed via automated pipelines. We also host a BrewTap. So it's easy for anyone having Mac to install this platform and start working with it. We are really excited to take this platform to the next level and make it available to the larger base, if not as a complete platform. If some of the reusable modules, we definitely want to have that hosted on our Capital One's public GitHub org. So this concludes our presentation. We will be more than happy to take any questions that you may have. And if you like what you saw, do visit our booth in Exhibit Hall. You will find some of the representatives there, and we are hiring. Plus, you can get a free t-shirt if you visit our booth as well. So thanks.